So Tar is a movie about classical music. If you're watching this review, I would figure you at least know that much. I think it's probably going to be in the, what the fuck, thumbnail I'm going to put up for this video. Here's what I would say. Don't let that deter you. In fact, it might even be a recommendation, because if a movie can be this exciting to this many people and be about a topic that unappealing, popularly unappealing, it really says something about it. I'll tell you, for me, I never had any kind of a footing in classical music. It seemed like something good to study to, and that was about it. I figured there was something there because people were excited about it, and there were people who, you know, thought that it was worth hours and hours of their time, and that always makes me think, well, there must be something there. But it wasn't until this movie that I started to see what that might be. So the main character, Lydia Tarr, she is impressive. She is imposing. She is superlative in her field. To give a sense of that, the movie Tarr is indicative of the fact that she's known in her field simply as Tarr. And to be on a last name basis in any kind of field means you've done something right. Now, for her, you see this right away. The movie opens with a New Yorker interview where she's discussing classical music, and you can see at once that she is someone who knows her shit. She commands the audience, she commands the room, she answers questions with ease and elegance, and not in a way that is particularly human. Not in a way that makes you feel any kinship with her, because that's not Tar's thing. Tar's thing is to be above others. Tar aspires to greatness. And what's interesting about her is that she achieves it. And this is maybe what makes the movie so enthralling to me, is that when you see greatness like this, it's just kind of breathtaking. At one point, she describes Beethoven as an artist of magnitude and inevitability. And that's kind of her. She has a presence that is above and beyond others, and she is undeniable. One of the things that's so cool about this movie is that very excellence makes classical music come alive. It makes her medium come alive. You start to see, first of all, you know, she is a conductor, and you start to see that the interaction between composers and conductors is one in which it's kind of unique in art. It's one in which a composer creates this work of art that has narrative, it has structure, it has theme, it has all these constituent parts that go into making any kind of art that progresses through time. But unlike a movie or a book, it has a strong degree of interpretation, kind of like a piece of, like a painting, like a piece of fine art. But what's different is that whereas with fine art, there's just the audience and the piece of art itself, the composer leaves music that is to be interpreted by a single person, the conductor, who uses the instruments of an entire symphony to bring out this artistry. And so this idea of artistic intention in the composer, what did they mean? What were the emotions they were feeling? What is each beat, each measure, each component piece, what is it looking for to express what was going on in the composer's intention in creating the piece? That's the conductor's role. And it's a very cool thing. I don't know of anything else quite like it in art. With Tarr, you see this, and you see it both in how she does the actual conducting of symphonies, which you see some of, but not a lot, but you also see it in, there's this one beautiful scene, I'll add it here, but she's interrogating this student. And, you know, I think the culture war elements of this scene are going to get the most play, which is too bad, because it's not, to me, this scene is amazing, not because she's criticizing the student for rejecting the Western canon and rejecting, you know, white men because he's a, you know, queer person of color. It's that she shows how this music for her is transcendent and genuinely so, and she does it by playing this famous Bach piece.
Come on, Max. Indulge me. Let's allow Bach a similar gaze. Sit. Now, this is all filigree, right? I mean, it could be a first-year piano student. Or Schroeder playing for Lucy. Or Glenn Gould, for that matter. Now, it's not until it changes. You get inside it that you hear what it really is. It's a question. And an answer. Which begs another question. There's a humility in Bach. He's not pretending he's certain about anything. Because he knows that it's always the question that involves the listener. It's never the answer, right? Now, the big question for you is, what do you think, Max?
You play really well. But nowadays, white male cis composers, just not my thing.
Don't be so eager to be offended. The narcissism of small differences leads to the most boring conformity.
So with Tar's greatness comes her desire to be great. And the movie also excels here in depicting the psychological dimensions of Tar, someone who is known simply by her last name because she is that big a deal in her field. And the movie makes very clear, that's exactly where she intended to end up. In fact, she demanded to end up. She made her entire being be about ending up in this rarefied air. So take Good Will Hunting, right? The main character there, he is a very reluctant great, right? He's a genius. He's so intelligent, you know, pops off the page. But what he wants to do is just hang out in Boston, be with Ben Affleck, you know, get girls' numbers and make fun of the Harvard guys and just run around doing some hood rat shit with his friends. And he's pushed into being great. Tar is the exact opposite of Will Hunting. Tar changed her name from Linda to Lydia, because Lydia Tar sounds a lot better. And by the way, I don't think Tar was her last name. The movie doesn't tell you this, but we end up seeing her childhood home.
Make it 40. Thank you.
Which she has very clearly forsaken. It's a very much middle American, middle class type of house. And I just would find it a surprise if there was the Tar family living there with a little accent over the A. I'm pretty sure that this is a person who has forsaken her name, has forsaken the family she grew up with, and has forsaken any chance of connection with other people. And the movie is clear on this. Tar treats other people like shit, and it's not because she wants to grind them down particularly, it's that she doesn't care. So take another series here, take Succession. Logan Roy wants to dominate. He wants to push other people down, he wants to beat them, he wants to outcompete them, he wants to dominate them. Tar's not like this, I don't think. She's an ubermensch in the same way. She has a will to greatness. But unlike Logan Roy, she doesn't really care about what happens to other people. She just wants to raise herself up to be one of the anointed. It's also not that Tar is particularly solipsistic. It's not that she lives in her own little world. She very much respects the greats of her field. So we see later in the movie, when she's at that childhood home, her watching these tapes of a great composer and very much connecting with it, partly because of the music, I think, but also partly because I think she took this example of how to be a great artist and bent herself in exactly that image. What she wanted more than anything was to be great, and she was. She achieved her goal, but it came at the cost of making her entire life be about herself and her vision and her dreams. And one thing I really liked about the movie is the movie doesn't tell you two facts, which are really important about this type of ambition. One is it necessary? Did Tar need to forsake everybody else? Did she need to be so alienated from all of the rest of everyone except for, you know, those handful of composers she actually respects? Did she need to be so alienated to end up so great? And I don't think the movie tells you that. It also, I would argue, though this one is debatable, I would argue it also doesn't tell you whether it was a good thing for her to do that. So some movies that kind of depict these kind of Ubermensch type figures, they give you an answer pretty clearly. So take There Will Be Blood. There Will Be Blood, if you make it to the end of the movie, which you should, because it's a great movie. The end of the movie is not exactly subtle with where this guy has ended up, right? I mean, he's got a sweet bowling alley, but he is not, you know, throwing strikes down there with his buddies and eating hot dogs. He is beating a man to death with a bowling pin, right? He's got this dusty old house where he just gets drunk alone and he's miserable, very clearly, and he's lost his mind. So that one is telling you that his will to power was bad, right? There's other depictions, maybe less often in movies, but like you see it in sports a lot, of people who have a single-minded focus on excellence and they're celebrated for it. So like Michael Jordan. I mean, Michael Jordan is an asshole. He's well known to be a hard guy to get along with, but people want to be like Mike. Michael Jordan is, you know, the greatest, and we buy his shoes, at least I sure did when I was younger. And there's really no sense in which people say, hey, should Michael Jordan have been like he was? No, we celebrate him for being that single-minded. Or, you know, I also just finished a book, The Agony and the Ecstasy, which is about Michelangelo. And it's a lot about artistic passion. Like, Michelangelo cared more than anything about carving, about, you know, creating beautiful figures out of stone. Now, granted, he wasn't quite as big of a dick as either Michael Jordan or Tar, but, you know, really, he was single-mindedly passionate. And that book depicts it in a positive light. It's pretty clear. Tar, I don't think, does that. Tar lets you wonder whether this taste of being anointed, being amazing and excellent, is worthwhile. Especially the first half of the movie, I think, leaves you with this question of, there's this trade Tar has made where she gets to be special and she has to feel alone by doing so. And the movie lets you wonder whether it's worth it. And then things change. So I would say that Tar's downfall, which I'll discuss in a second, does not necessarily show that the trade she made in order to be great was a bad one. Because while she has a downfall, it's not really inherent to her being alienated from others. It's not the transactional nature with which she views life. It's a very particular way in which she exercises that power, and that she coerces basically sexual favors from subordinates and then kind of dispenses with them, which is, yeah, like, you know, a downstream of her personality, but I don't think it's inherent to it. I think what's inherent to it is just this single-minded focus on greatness. Now, Tar does end up with a downfall. This is basically the last hour of the 2.5 hour or so movie. And I will say this, I like the way it's set up. I think it's interesting how it's set up. I think it poses interesting questions and has plenty of tension behind it. I do not like the way it's executed. So the setup goes like this. Tar has a pattern of inappropriate relationships with subordinates. And with one particular subordinate, she has, as it turns out, basically destroyed this young woman's career. we end up learning that she's been sending letters of disrecommendation to symphonies that inquire after her over and over. Now, the movie is actually ambiguous about what exactly Tara has done. It does seem pretty clear that she's had an inappropriate relationship with a subordinate. It's not a minor, it's not a child, but it's a subordinate, so abuse of power. But whether it's just that, or whether it has I would say significantly worse moral dimensions of then destroying this person's life after they've stopped serving a purpose for her, is left unclear. She clearly tries to destroy this woman's career, but is that because of this woman's mental instability, or is the mental instability caused by Tara's actions? The movie is actually not entirely clear about this. The young woman does end up committing suicide. And so whatever has happened, either Tara was inappropriate and then callous about this young woman, or Tara has blood on her hands from causing a suicide. Whichever of those two is the case, and I think the ambiguity there is interesting, this suicide sets off a series of events that leads to Tara's demise. Now, here I go from fawning over this movie to having some real criticisms, which I don't like leveling because I was so into this movie. I at the end of it, to cut forward to, you know, my little rating at the end, still a huge fan of this movie. But here I really regret the way they choose to handle this. So there's two things that happen here. One is the movie's kind of metaphysical reality changes. So up until this point, it's just been entirely realistic, right? Like there's no cinematic license taken where, you know, weird things happen, or, you know, there's no like deus ex machina. There's nothing like magical. It's just, you know, movie about human beings in the world. But then things that start happening that are just nightmarish, I don't think there's any other word. I mean, it's like a nightmare. So at one point, Tara gets trapped in an underground, sewage-ridden series of apartments that she's lost in. And then there's a large dog that chases her and looks set on attacking her. And it looks entirely like a nightmare. And then another time, Tara's mentally challenged neighbor knocks on the door and forces her to come up to carry the mentally challenged neighbor's elderly, decrepit, nude, and sick mother who's fallen on the floor back into bed. And so she's holding this emaciated, naked old lady with this screaming, mentally challenged woman. I mean, again, it's completely unmoored from like the total realism that had, you know, that the movie was built off of before. And now we're in this nightmare mode, which is, to me, just kind of abrupt and unnecessary. And, you know, it's just like I'm watching a different movie now. And, you know, I think the way you defend it is saying, well, Tara's life is falling apart. She's being publicly canceled. It feels like you're in a nightmare, which is like, okay, you can depict kind of that feeling of like panic and agony without becoming untethered to like the basic features of reality that the movie was working in. You know, like there's one scene where there's a metronome tick-tock in Tara's there's a scene earlier where there's a metronome going tick-tock in the middle of the night, somehow like spontaneously became unlatched and starts making this kind of scary Edgar Allan Poe tick-tock. That is earned, right? Like that's still realistic, but it's kind of threatening and ominous, and it has that kind of feeling of like, is this a bad omen? And you don't really necessarily believe in omens, but it feels kind of scary. That's subtle. That's earned. That would make sense. But the, you know, getting lost in a maze of scary apartments being chased by a big dog, that's not real. That's a dream. And so, you know, we just lapse into this kind of fake world that I just did not feel was necessary or helpful, or I just didn't like it, you know. Then it's also clumsy during this downfall. Like, the most clear depiction of this is this video that goes around that is apparently causing everybody to turn on Tar. I'll show it here.
Back to the piano bench up there to a super hot young woman. That's very good. Now, you could masturbate, but what are you actually doing to me?
That video is not how public cancellations work. I've seen a lot of them. I'm sure plenty of us have. If you're an online person, you've seen them. It doesn't work by something that's obviously a ham-fisted, you know, screw job by somebody who's bent on, you know, getting you. At least not one that is so clumsily done. Like, it's the equivalent of, like, you know, photoshopping Barack Obama in a Hitler salute and being like, look, now he's gonna lose the presidency. Like, she's not gonna lose the Berlin Philharmonic by something that, you know, anybody with, you know, like a half of a decent IQ would be able to tell was fake. It's stupid. And that's too bad, because there was plenty to cancel her over for. Like, you could have had an interesting... If you want to talk about cancel culture, which I also kind of wish the movie hadn't, because there was a lot of interesting stuff going on with the psychology and the classical music and the power dynamic story, where it part of the downfall. That's all interesting. The cancel culture, you know, like Twitter mob thing, is just feels kind of cheap. But if we're going to talk about that, let's do an interesting version of it. Let's go back to that scene where the BIPOC kid is saying he's not interested in the Western canon and she's going after him for it. Now, that video is, yes, based on that scene, but it's a ham-fisted screw job. Let's actually take her words, and that could be fodder for cancellation. You know, she's attacking this person of color who is having an issue with the very white history of classical music. That certainly could be grounds for cancellation. If the movie had lingered on that, it could have, you know, asked the audience to reckon with, you know, is this fair? Would I have agreed with this? You know, where do my sympathies lie? Instead, it kind of takes the easy way out and says, oh, the cancellation is actually about this dumb little video. Another example of this clumsiness is the climax of Tar's demise, which is she bum rushes the stage and, you know, she looks like Ray Lewis just tackling the shit out of her, the replacement conductor on the stage of the Berlin Philharmonic. And the whole thing just feels pretty blunt, not very subtle, and it's kind of hard for me to believe Cate Blanchett is gonna, you know, be pulling those free safety type of hits. So I just did not like how the demise was handled. I thought it was unnecessarily divorced from the previous act of the movie, and I thought even on its own terms, setting aside whether I liked the kind of nightmarish feeling that the movie decides to wade into, it just, there's a lot of clumsiness here that wasn't there elsewhere, and it was frankly surprising given how masterful the rest of the movie felt. With that being said, I still thought this movie was excellent. I thought it was one of the best things I've seen in a while. If it wins Best Picture, I will be excited about that. I don't care that much about the Oscars, but to the extent I care, it deserves to be considered one of the very best movies of this year, maybe the best, and that's despite big flaws in the final act, in my view, because what came before it is special. It's special to see greatness depicted like this. It's special to be given this entry point into an entire domain of art that most of us do not have much experience with. Cate Blanchett is extremely good in this role. And the overriding takeaway from this movie is, wow, that was really cool. The next sentence has to be, I wish it didn't have those flaws that got me all riled up. But you know, the third sentence is, that being said, awesome. So I'm going to give it 3.5 stars, not 4, but 3.5, and an easy 3.5. You know, it would have been 4 if the last act was just good. It just had to be, not even great, just if it had kind of landed the plane. Didn't think it did. Doesn't matter. Great movie. Hope you enjoy. And let me know if you do. Let me know if you do. And also let me know if you liked this video. If you didn't, please let me know if how I can improve. I'm just getting started with these, and I hope they're of interest, but I'm sure I can also do a whole lot better. So if you have any thoughts, suggestions, please let me know. Thanks for your time, and I hope to see you again here soon.